It's my great pleasure to introduce our keynote speaker for lunch, very dear friend of mine, Roberto Rivivon, Professor Roberto Rivivon. He is the Society of Sloan Fellows, Professor of Management at the MIT Sloan School of Management. Roberto is a research associate at the National Bureau of Economic Research. He's also a member of the Census Bureau's Scientific Advisory Committee. Roberto is Venezuelan. He is a founding member of the Billion Prices Project, which about 5 or 6 years ago transitioned into price stats, as I was talking about earlier, as part of our State Street proprietary indicators. Roberto is obsessed by measurements, as you're about to find out, and particularly why we only make things when it's too late, and most of the time we mismeasure them. He has been named Teacher of the Year, and also recognized he's won Excellence in Teaching, both of which 3 times at MIT. Now, for all this, I got to tell you, Roberto's not as smart as he thinks he is, okay? Because Roberto is a Barcelona fan. I'm talking soccer, all right? And his team suffered a humiliating defeat to the mighty Liverpool a couple of weeks ago. And I know Liverpool supporter. Thank you very much. So, yeah, Barcelona went out in the semi-finals of Champions League. Humiliated. And Roberto still hasn't forgiven him. But he is still a close and dear friend. And he's about to embark on his most important role, actually. And he's going to act as the unofficial mentor for my son, as he embarks on a PhD in behavioral economics. And Roberto's going to help you with that. So, without further ado, please welcome Roberto Rivivon.
Yes, my first act as a mentor is to teach the son which things to truly support. First, thank you very much for the invitation and for being here. And my wife loves when I speak at lunch because it's at my age I need to do more diets and less eating and conferences. So she always asks me, "Are you speaking at lunch?" It's great. So it is great also to be back in LA. And what I would like to do is to tell you a little bit about two things. One is about social well-being. How do we measure social well-being in a society? So one is to measure social well-being in a society, and the second one is to actually talk about measurement in particular. At MIT, I have a framework that I use to try to determine when a society or a community or a country is somewhat sustainable. It's called PROMISE. The P stands for personal, R for relationships, O for organizations, M for markets and the economy, I for institutions, S for social and political, and E for the environment. And truly the way I think about it is that in order to build a truly sustainable society, we have to pay attention to all these 7 dimensions. In fact, if you don't, then you suffer different types of diseases. So for example, if you're a super happy country and you're a disaster on everything else, that doesn't look very sustainable, that type of disease we call Brazil. If you are a total disaster and then super depressed, we call that Argentina, okay? So, but on the other hand, if you have a society that works, everything works fine, but the society is very upset and citizens are depressed, that doesn't look very sustainable. So in fact, if I were to ask you to tell me what matters to you, and in fact, I tend to do that in my classes, most people actually put a little bit of weight on all the dimensions. I mean, you care about your personal well-being, about your relationships, about organizations where you work, you care about efficiency in the economy, you care about institutions and the rule of law, you care about society, you care about income inequality, you care about the environment. So one interesting thing that happens when people actually think about these dimensions carefully is that you tend to put weight on all of it. You care about all of it. Now, another interesting thing is that people care about these different dimensions differently. So
be more environmentally conscious, and they will put a bigger weight on the environment. Some others will be more, for example, my son, before actually he fell in love with his girlfriend, he got put almost zero in relationship. Now it's like 99% on relationships. And truly what happened is that different individuals will have different ways of these valuations. And very importantly, those valuations are not as stable through time. When we were young, we used to have a very different set of values, what we care. And as we go along, we marry, we have kids, we change those valuations and the things that we emphasize in our life. Now, what is incredibly interesting is that even though everybody kind of pay attention, or we like to pay attention to all because they value, in practice, their actions are not doing that. Most of us here actually do not respond to our values. There's a tremendous dissonance between what we actually do in life and what we actually say that we care about. One of the reasons why this dissonance occurs is because it's very difficult for us to understand the consequences of our actions. Very difficult to understand the impact of our actions. And we tend to underestimate how important they are. We tend to underestimate how this affects us in general. In fact, we tend to act based on incentives. We tend to act based on what we measure. So, for example, there are some aspects in life that we care a lot. But I'm pretty sure that you can tell me some of them, and we would care about these things differently. For those, you don't need any monetary benefit to actually do it. Is that okay? For example, in my case, with my family, I don't need anybody to give me any incentives to care about my wife or my three kids. It's automatically built up in my set of values and my set of actions. But there are other things that I might care a little bit less. And for those, what happens is that if I don't have incentives, I don't tend to actually do it. For example, exercise. I do know that exercise seems to be good for humankind. But as a lazy Venezuela, it's very difficult for me to exercise. I don't want to do it. I don't know you guys, but it's hard. And therefore, I need incentives. So, you know, imagine that somebody says, well, I'm going to pay you for doing exercises. Well, they better pay me a whole lot of money because actually, I don't want to do it. So, truly, what occurs in life is that because we have these different valuations and we have these forms of measurement, our actions do not correspond. In general, actually, we act based on incentives. And this is one of the things that I think we economists can have wrong. For us economists, the word motivation and incentives, we use them interchangeably. I actually think that that's a mistake. I need incentives exactly because I am not motivated. If anything, they are exactly the opposite. So, that's what leads to my topic about measurement. Very difficult to have any incentives in any society when you measure badly. How can we actually impose, for example, or give someone incentives about labor morale in our organizations if we have no idea how to measure labor morale? So, that's kind of my obsession with measurement. My obsession with measurement comes from the fact that I think that we actually measure life horribly. And what I mean horribly is that I really think that the fact that we as a species have made some good choices in the past is the outcome of luck and a miracle and not about wisdom and information. No chance. For example, we do not measure happiness at all, or sadness for that matter. We only count the cases of depression or suicides. We do not measure the quality of our relationship. We only count separations. We don't measure when a society is getting upset. We wait until they riot. We don't measure human rights violations properly. We wait until we have 100,000 people in a mass grave. We don't measure the quality of a political system. We wait until we get an idiot being elected. We don't wait. We do not, under any circumstances,
that I think we measure very badly. Reasons why we measure very badly. And I want to give different examples of different aspects of organizations as I go on. First one, we tend to measure very late. And what I mean late is not with a delay, late in a process. I learned this by studying a lot of consumption of drugs, not by practicing. But we count, the city of Boston counts the number of people that have an overdose or die from an overdose. And very rarely you move from no consumption of drugs to an overdose. Also, what happens is that you try in the process, you're consuming more and more and more, you develop an addiction, and once that addiction has developed, then you increase the likelihood and the risk of having an overdose. So there's a process that you move from 0 to 100 relatively slowly. We do not measure a single time what is happening in that process, ever. We wait until the end. And then when the very extreme event has taken place, that's what we measure. We don't measure our sexual hostility in the labor market, in the organizations. We don't. We don't measure how we treat women. We don't. We wait until we have treated one lady sufficiently bad that she decides to go to a labor court and file a complaint. I don't know, but that, I have 2 daughters, that will be the definition of too late. So we measure these extreme outcomes only because they're easy to measure, too late. Because measuring the process of how you get to that point is extremely hard, so we just measure at the end. We also measure very infrequently. The numbers that I just told you, they're usually produced once a year. So this is like me going to the doctor. I go every year to the doctor. She has been the same doctor I have had at MIT for 17 years. By the way, after 17 years, she finally gave me her first name. You know, doctors here are kind of not very friendly. But anyway, so Elaine finally, after 17 years, we're on first name basis now, which is, I'm glad. So we Latinos, it will take like 5 minutes and 2 beers, okay? And you will give me your social security. In any case. But, I go every year, and you know what she says? She says, Roberto, you are 1 year older, your hair is 1 inch shorter, and you have 1 pound heavier. So, other than learning that I'm older, uglier, and heavier, I have no idea what is the purpose of that conversation. Like, how is that going to make me suddenly eat more kale?
the first one, very bad one, was here in Stanford. That was about 6 to 5 years ago. Then about 2 or 3 years ago, we're mostly on Hollywood. Have you heard any case of sexual harassment in colleges, let's say in the last 3 months? The military? Hollywood? There are two options, my friends. One, we are treating women great.
Wow!
Or we are not paying attention. What do you think is more likely? Number two, you understand that the media is extremely small capacity. You tend to believe that the media is important and big because they have a lot of words, but they use the same word 20 million times. So this is like a statistic. You have 20 million observations, which is the same observation 20 million times. They have an incredibly small capacity to capture your attention. And therefore, what occurs is that we measure something when we're out of rage. We measure the number of, for example, people from Syria that died in escaping from Syria. And why we started? Because we saw one baby in Greece in the beach. And we actually reported the number of people that were escaping from Syria almost continuously in the media for a month. After a month, we stopped reporting. You know that today, actually, there are more people dying escaping from Syria than 6 years ago, when that occurred. Just that we are not outraged. But you see, to solve important problems in society, the really important ones, like racism, discrimination, our protection of the environment, how we treat each other, how we respect each other, for those problems, it is really difficult to actually solve them when we only pay attention for 1 weekend. Really difficult. The fourth aspect that I don't like about how we measure is the fact that we concentrate on statistics that create this false sense of accomplishment. So, again, this was a discussion that I had with the district attorney. I'm not going to say the city, but it was New York. But they have a division about health, and they were very happy that actually the number of people that were dying out of an overdose or opioid were coming down. And I said, well, but they are coming down because now we have this drug that can revive them. He said, yes. He said, so the fact that you have less deaths doesn't mean that they're consuming less drugs. He said, man, it means that you avoided the very bad outcome that you're measuring. Let me give you another example. We count women, don't we? I mean, we do this in MIT all the time. At MIT, by the way, we're super happy that MIT, the undergrad, has 52% women and 48% men. So we are. And again, there's this stereotype that women don't study science, and I'm telling you, I see them all over the place. So there are a lot of women that are actually studying science. And but the question is not, I mean, I think we should try to get to 50-50. But the question is, are you treating them better? But the fact that you move the statistics from 25 to 35, does that mean that you treat them better, or you just have them as collection items? What about from 35 to 35? And the problem with that is that when you reach the numbers of 45 and 50, you feel that you have done your job. As if now, they just do nothing about it. I don't like the way we measure. I hope that I have convinced you how badly we do it. So, I have devoted my life actually to try to think about how to measure these things. I'm going to tell you a little bit about inflation rate, but I will tell you more about how we're trying to measure ethical behavior. I think that we have to change completely our approach to this. And I have five pillars of our
show next year. They want to know, did you like the food? Did you like the topics? Did you enjoy the place? Did you enjoy the infrastructure? Everything. They're going to ask you why. Not because they're going to fix it. You are receiving that too late. Okay? Because you're screwed. I don't like chicken. Sorry, baby. Chicken, two salads. There's another salad here for the non-chicken guy. But in the end, they are not going to fix this conference. But you are a very representative, very relevant audience for the next one. And therefore, they want to know. So please feel your service. It's clear. And I know it's super costly, but it's the only way they can and can improve what it is. But I think we need to move out of service. Has to be a non-disruptive mechanism. That's the second characteristic. We need to measure continuously, and we need to measure in a non-intrusive way. Such a way that we can learn something about ourselves and learn about something about our organizations, trying to minimize that intrusiveness. Not everything that I do is non-intrusive. I work a lot with law enforcement, so I want to be intrusive. I am working on human trafficking. I'm working on the worst behavior of humankind, okay? So discrimination. My wife says that that's the reason why I'm so happy. Because I'm so miserable and everything. But in some sense, I'm working on human trafficking. So that one, I want to be inclusive. But that's except for law enforcement aspects. I want to be the least inclusive possible. Third, very important characteristics. Whatever we do, it has to be open. And the reason is that the nature of the data and the nature of our behavior changes dramatically. And if you think that the internet moves fast, my friends, the nature of the data collection moves even faster than that. So therefore, whatever we design today, maybe likely, it will be useless 10 years from now. Completely and absolutely useless. And we do not have the statistical methods to deal with that. That cannot be solved with artificial intelligence. The only way to solve that is called human judgment. So knowing and understanding the phenomena, there's no substitute for that. And again, a computer, I always say that it should never be called artificial intelligence. It should be artificial stupidity. Yeah, my example is my son. Well, no, that he's super smart. But my example is my son. I remember I told my son, this is a chair, that's a chair, that's a chair. And I gave him three observations. And from that, he could figure out perfectly what a chair was. So with a very small data set, he was able to actually produce tremendous predictions. 99% of them were accurate. And actually, we humans are extremely good at that. And our brain somehow has that capacity. With three observations, we can make a prediction. By the way, that's why a lot of people also lose money, but that's a minor point. That means that because of judgment, we make mistakes. But we don't need big data to actually be able to make a prediction. A computer needs pictures of 10,000 chairs to be able to detect one. They need massive, that's why it's called big data, is because I'm super stupid. So I need 10,000 observations to be able to predict one chair. Then they have zero capacity of imagination. My thought experiment is to ask people, can you imagine an elephant over a chair? I say that, and you immediately, in your brains, you actually figure it out. Everybody pictures in their brain an elephant on top of a chair, even though you have never seen one. A computer will say, impossible. See? It will not actually have the capacity to shrink the elephant, which is more or less what everyone here did. Is that okay? You shrink the elephant and you put it on the chair. So that aspect, which is with almost no data to produce a prediction and produce creativity, is what actually makes humans so incredibly different. And what that also implies is that the nature of how we're going to collect the data and the nature of how we're going to train these models need to include that judgment. Severely. So we need to have open sources. Whatever we do, it has to be more open. We're gathering a lot of data. And most people think that the values in the data, my friends, the data is a commodity. The values in the analysis of that data, the type of answers that we get from that data, you have to actually change dramatically. advertising, almost all of you, actually, in your phones, you are giving away your private information to a lot of companies. And I had this discussion about 2 weeks with my younger girl. She doesn't have me and find my friends. Okay? So I am a friend, but not, I cannot find her. Anyway, so, and so I, she's 20 years old, she's in Brown, she's a studying psychology. And I said, you know what? Why not? I said, you have all these free apps, and you are voluntarily giving your information to Google. How do you feel about that? She said, no, that's fine, because information is not valuable. Well, if information is not valuable, give me your GPS to me, yes, find my friends. Like, if it's not valuable, it's not valuable for everyone. Why this is has to be valuable to me, but not to Google? I said, no, because you're going to stop me. Well, that's exactly what Google is doing. They're stalking you. I will be stalking you with love. They're stalking you to make money. Like, why my love is less valuable than money? I don't have very find my friends. That didn't work, by the way. But truly, we are violating privacy dramatically. And the day you construct daily measures, we will be understanding aspects of individuals much closer. I will know when you have a fever, when you will have a flu, and therefore we need to actually protect individuals. So these are four pillars. One, we need to measure continuously, non-intrusively. We need to actually have an open source, and we need to protect privacy. Any measure that has these four characteristics by construction has to be imperfect. Has to be imperfect. And therefore we need to learn that, for example, when we compute inflation rates are going to be an imperfect measure of what truly actually happens. It doesn't matter how good you are, it doesn't matter how much information you have, if you are going to actually protect privacy and do this in a continuous manner, your measurement needs by construction to be actually constructed to be imperfect. So, these principles I apply to everything. And by the way, when I say I apply, I actually do nothing. I find someone super smart, okay? A student from a PhD, they do, I motivate them. I tell them there are 5 pillars, is that okay? But I use kind of my like a more romantic voice, like, yes, we have to actually produce all these measurements to save human life. Then they do it like crazy, and I do the hardest part, which I take all the credits, okay? So what we have done is to try to think about, first, we actually started trying to measure depression very unsuccessfully. I have to say, we couldn't. Still today, more than 17 years later, I'm still working on trying to detect sadness, anger. By the way, I can detect anger perfectly. So this is from your phone. So actually, these are apps that on the phone are apps for self-awareness. I detect anger before you are angry. Why? Because it's your tone of voice. Now, what is interesting is that when you guys talk to a friend, you know if the friend is upset, if he's sad, he's happy, don't you? On the phone, I don't have to see the friend. That I cannot replicate yet. But angry, man, that is simple. Especially how many times they swear is a very good indicator. No, but truly, we're still working. The second one that we did was inflation. And don't ask me how we move from depression to inflation. Maybe they are somewhat related. But with Alberto Cavallo, we started constructing daily measures of inflation rate. What we did was to first change the frequency of how the data was going to be collected. So it was daily. Second, non-intrusive. Instead of doing a survey, we went to online retailers. Third, we changed the procedures and the methods. A lot of the they collect a representative sample. Instead of collecting one shed in Sana, we collected all of them. So we changed actually the scope. We increased the number of data points by more than 100-fold in almost every country. And then we actually changed the methods of computation of inflation. And that became at the beginning of MIT, was called the Million Prices Project. And later, with the partnership of Statesfield, we were able to actually scale that, and we now collect data for about 70 countries where we produce inflation rates daily for about 2023. Almost every statistical office on Earth is today changing their procedures to what Alberto and I did 10 years ago. Almost
Un segundo. The violentos changed the way they compute clothing. Alberto was the one that taught the statistical office how to do that. France is changing the procedures. I take care of it. But what is interesting is that I already think that our methods need to be improved. So they are 10 years behind. So we better get our act together and improve our procedures so they can continue. But these indexes are trying to measure the same phenomena. It's just because it's a different procedure, different data set, different methodologies. They need to have to be complementary to what you tend to see in the methods. What I'm working right now is on working on trying to think about measuring ethical behavior. And you know this as corporate social responsibility, or ESG. And again, the first thing that I did was to try to understand what are the discrepancies that exist in ESG. I don't know how many of you actually have worked with data from ESG. Raise your hand. Okay, I have, let's say that's about 20%. Okay. So, one thing that happens with ESG is that people are trying to measure what is implicit, what they would like to measure. What they would like to measure is what is your willingness to actually pollute. That's what we would like to measure. Because it's the intention. I would like to know if your intent is to pollute and produce CO2 emissions. We can measure that, or at least we think we can't, and therefore what we do is we tend to measure only how much actually CO2 emissions you actually have produced. Or we think that we can measure that. We are trying to measure how you treat workers, but we can measure exactly how you treat workers, so we measure turnover. In Europe, then we measure, for example, labor law and labor court complaints. In Europe, it's much easier for them, and it's less costly as a worker to go and complain to a labor court. In the United States, it's kind of a work suicide almost. So different countries will have different methods and different methodologies and different measures. One very sad aspect of this measurement is that I take the same company measured by two rating agencies, and those ratings are probably correlated on 30% of it. In other words, if I take 10 companies and I look at two rating agencies rating those 10 companies, the ratings are less correlated than the number of kids that die swimming in a swimming pool, drowning in a swimming pool, and the number of movies in which Nicolas Cage is the main actor. That is correlated in 67%. Which, by the way, if you think about this as causality, we can do a lot of good by just killing Nicolas Cage. You have to be kidding me. This is less, for example, credit rating agencies don't have that problem. If I take your FICO scores and I compute the correlation, they are typically correlated in something like 95-97%. Because it's a method that we understand very well how to compute. In computing ethical behavior, we have no clue. And therefore, because we have no clue, we have a proliferation of data providers, and these proliferation of data providers are creating a tremendous amount of confusion. So the first thing I have done is actually to try to understand the sources of these discrepancies. And the rating agencies know, because I have told them, that I want their data to destroy them. And surprisingly, they give me the data. And actually, I zero lies. I tell them, I am going to take your data and I'm going to tell you what is wrong with you. And the people, yes, please, here's my data. So I just want you to understand the size of the confusion. They understand this is a problem. If you don't measure how people are treating each other, what is the impact on a community, if we don't have an impact on the environment, then it's really hard to actually make any decisions. If you care about that, it would be very hard for you to actually even evaluate that. So a couple of things that I've learned from this process, and then I will give some time for this. So, first, very interesting, is that about 50% of the discrepancy,
what has called the discrepancy. It's because the two rating agencies are trying to measure the same thing, but they use different data sources. One uses media, the other one uses reports, the other one uses accidents, the other one uses some other thing. And truly what that implies is that we do have a problem of measurement of particular attributes. And there's no agreement how to measure, for example, CO2 emissions. Which sounds like trivial, but there's one that is, for example, lobbying. Meaning, the question of lobbying is, do you lobby, yes or no? Don't you think that that seems to me like that should be simple to agree on? That, at the level of the, at that level of granularity, they're actually negatively correlated. So, truly the state of these very narrowly defined categories, we have a tremendous amount of discrepancies. But the way I see this as, you know, half full, is that the other 50% is because they are using different rules about how to get that granular data and collect one ranking. I want to talk a little bit about that, because truly what that means is that 50% of the confusion could be actually resolved by sharing the raw data. And then each one of us, we put its values on all these categories, and then you will just have the ranking that is consistent to your values and your views. So if you care a lot about the environment, well, then put a lot of weight on the raw data that is about environmental measures. But if you care a lot about, you know, society and communities, then put a lot on, you know, the accidents that you produce in the mining company and stuff like that. I mean, just, I think we all have different views. It would be very easy for us to actually resolve 50% of the disagreement that exists. There's something interesting about those rules that I don't like. It's the fact that people tend to average. I am a US citizen now, so I have learned that competition is the only important thing in life. Is that okay? That's why Lee is making fun of the fact that I am a Barcelona fan, which just shows that it doesn't matter how good I am at measurement, I'm still humanly irrational and stupid. But in some sense, one thing that occurs to these rules is that we average categories that are very different, that we should not average them. For example, I'm not gonna, there's one rating agency, very likely you don't know it, it's a tiny data provider. But they are constructing a variable that I find fascinatingly important, which is tolerance. So this is not about firms, it's about communities. So they measure tolerance toward women, tolerance towards minorities, tolerance toward religious differences, tolerance toward sexual preference differences. And by the way, they go out to the communities and measure that. Sounds, I mean, that info sounds very impressive to me, at least. By the way, that sounds like an important variable. I would like to know how tolerant we are. Then what they do is they compute an average for those numbers. And I say to them, the average. I said, well, because, you know, societies have different levels of all tolerance. I said, no, shouldn't be an average. And I said, do the following thought experiment. That, you know, you average, you know, this tolerance, and then your son comes to you and says, Dad, you know, I have decided that I'm going to try treat women better, and I will treat gays worse, but the average will be constant. Is that okay? What will you need your reaction? You see, these are not substitutes. It's the minimum. In fact, there's a social worker in DC. I have learned a lot from her. One of the statements that she said once to me is that you are as good as you treat the person the worst. So to the person that you treat the worst, that's how good you are. So in the case of tolerance, it's to which group you are have the least amount of tolerance. That's what defines what your tolerance is. And therefore, you see, averages is not the way to do this. But it's hard for us not to do averages. So if we continue in this way, and we have one ranking for every company, I can assure you one company is going to start making the following decision. Let me think about how many
woman I need to hire in the board so I can pollute one metric ton of CO2. Because that will keep the average constant, and therefore, you know, I have a trade-off between two attributes that, by the way, they should never be being put together. And furthermore, this is much worse when you think of some of these attributes about using child labor in production. So, I think that it's very important for us to embrace the complexity. It's very difficult for us to be able to measure reality on dimensions that are so different by just summarizing all that by one number. And furthermore, we will create the wrong incentives by doing that. Let me tell you finally a little bit. So I'm working a lot on trying to think about how to produce and disseminate that data in a way that all of us can use it, okay? But it cannot be a weighted average of the components. Is that clear? That's clear that it can happen. By the way, the behavior I have described has happened. So it's not like I made up this stuff, okay? It actually has happened. So we need to find a way to disseminate this data in a way that has to be used. And I don't know the answer. I promise you the day I have it, it will be in a bag. The last thing that I'm doing is that I am trying to solve measurement problems. And again, I'm going back to these issues of I need to be non-disruptive, non-intrusive, continuous, etc. So, at MIT, by the way, this is intrusive for the moment. I wanted to measure, improve how we treat each other at MIT. So I said, well, let's start with women. How do we treat women? And what's very interesting is first that I had to learn a lot about sexual harassment. Because sexual harassment, our language, is too broad. Like sexual misconduct can be anything, truly anything. So our language is very bad. So if I cannot even define it, it would be very difficult to measure it. So I spent about several years actually searching. There's a classification, Lorraine Fitzgerald, a professor at Michigan. She has a very good classification about what are the different aspects that happen in terms of sexual hostility in an organization. And when I was looking at all of that, I realized, oh, one of them I can measure. So I could measure, for example, respect. Does anybody know what mansplaining is? Raise your hand if you know what mansplaining is. Raise your hand. Suzanne, are you sure you know what mansplaining is? If not, I can explain it to you. That is exactly mansplaining. It's okay? Me, without knowing, actually, I think that I am entitled to explain. But what happens in organizations is that, for example, women will be interrupted more than men. And what we did was to put microphones on MIT students. These are super smart microphones that they detect when two individuals are talking to each other. They have a UV that they intercept. So therefore, if there's noise on the background, they know that that noise is not part of the conversation. Okay? So they are very smart microphones. And I measure interruptions in that world. And what was very interesting was to go through the whole process of MIT. At the beginning, when I put the microphones, of course, people started to behave really great. I keep going, what's that great presentation? Can you tell me again? No interruptions. By the way, I told people I'm going to measure interruptions at airtime. No? But then, you know, MIT, we're bastards as faculty. I mean, you understand that they pay us a crappy salary, and therefore the only thing that we have going on in our life is that we can humiliate other human beings. Is that okay? We call that for sex, exams, and stuff like that. So, you know, we actually just made the life of these students absolutely miserable. And after 1 week of pretending, the inner jerk comes out. Is that okay? They cannot do. And this is the same thing throughout all the summer. So something very interesting are the patterns of interruption. I am from Venezuela. My dad was from Argentina. My grandfather was from Italy. My mother was from Spain. So I'm genetically designed to interrupt people. Okay? It would be impossible for me not to interrupt a human being. And in fact, that is true in the data. When you look at the interruptions and you look at men, I'm going to talk only about men. What was very interesting is that you have people from Italy. They interrupt like crazy. And then the Spanish, and then all the Latinos. I mean, so we were all back on the top. On the lower level frequency of interruptions, you had Germans, Dutch, Nordic, Koreans, and Japanese. They were almost never interrupted. They were interrupted.
and this is what happens. And that's why we move the hands to guide you. No, no, that's another way. But what is very interesting is that the pattern of man has this pattern. But another thing that is very interesting is that irrespectively of your frequency of interruptions, men interrupted women 4 times more than men interrupted men. See, I am perfectly fine interrupting people because I love to interrupt people. But how do I feel that I interrupt women more than men? That was not genetically the same. What's incredibly interesting is that when you give this self-awareness to the people, they immediately change. Immediately. Most people will be ashamed of that statistic. They will not be ashamed of interruptions. They will assign that to culture. But they will be ashamed about how they interrupt. And in fact, I actually think that a lot of our unconscious biases are truly unmeasured biases. When somebody highlights that we're misbehaving, we're very likely to change. So what we're trying to do is to put that in an app. And we will deploy that on firms. So the idea is that we will put that in an app and provide statistics not only about the person, but more importantly about the organization. I realize that it's more effective to tell people at MIT we interrupt women 4 times more than men. That is a far more powerful thing than saying you are a jerk because you interrupted 7 times. Truly, truly, actually the other one. And a statistic about the organization creates a sense of belonging and identity to the organization. So we might be able to change cultures. Of course, I'm not going to be able to eliminate all forms of discrimination and all forms of treatment. Airtime. Women spoke 30% less than men. And you know what I also have from all of them in that summer? I have their grades. Their grades were completely unrelated to the patterns of interruptions or being interrupted. So we were interrupting really smart people. Let me finish with a story of why I think this is important for us. I think that if we don't measure ESG better, we're going to actually have a very negative realization at some point in time in the future. If we continue with the income inequality that we have, if we continue treating the workers the way we treat them, if we continue actually treating the environment the way we treat it, we are going to for sure have a very large negative realization. The income inequality will be translated in a political system. Look at Italy. If you don't like that, that's exactly where we're heading. If you don't like the way we treat the environment, well, look at India and China. That's where we're heading. So the problem is that these are very large negative realizations. Now, how big they are, we have no clue. When will they happen? We have no clue. What is the probability? We have no clue. And because we have no clue, we are acting and pretending as if this will never happen. And we will have what I call an oh shit moment. Because the day we hit the wall is when we're going to say, my God, I should have actually acted before. And we didn't. So let me just finish with a story about my wife and my daughter. This is my older daughter. She's a materials, even though I told her that she needs to study very broadly and stuff like that, she studied material science, computation. She wanted a STEM like crazy. But by the way, I think the emphasis on STEM is the incorrect emphasis for the future. I think that this is the least human of humans. We should be emphasizing creativity, empathy, ethics, presence, hope. These are the things that cannot be substituted by a computer. Solving a differential equation will be substituted by a computer. So we need a very broad type of education. My daughter, you know, did not follow my advice. She's like a super scientist, by the way. After 2 years of work, she's not using what she learned. So I told her, told you so. You know, when you're a parent, you should always practice that. It's okay? I actually didn't say that, but then he says, Dad, I'm going to do a master's. I said, yeah, that's what you do when you study the incorrect thing. I want to do a master in the Kennedy School. Yeah, that's super crap. Yeah. So, then she wants to go to MBA. So that's good. At least you will make money. So, but I remember when we were
students, actually, our daughter, she was waking up at bizarre early hours. We had my older daughter, my son. My wife was pregnant with a little one. And one of the things that we did every weekend was to walk in the mall, okay? Truly doing window shopping at 6 a.m., okay? Because they wake up very early, we had nothing to do, and then he said, let's go to the mall and just walk, not buy anything. And I remember one day we were walking in the mall, and this was the Native Mall, which was the largest mall in New England at the time. And my daughter says, Daddy, can we play hide and seek? To which I said, of course. And my wife said, no, this is such a big place. I said, yeah, there are so many places to hide and so many places to seek. It's kind of the progress. I mean, playing hide and seek in the living room is like for losers. So my wife says, no, because they can kidnap my daughter. I said, oh, good point. Anyway, we continue walking. And then I said to my wife, okay. If suddenly we hear on the announcement that a kidnapping has taken place, and that the kidnapper has left the building, well, will you allow us to play hide and seek then? To which my wife says, you are an idiot. I say, no, but wait a second, no. Because in the world, there are less kidnappers than kids. The conditional probability after the kidnapping has taken place goes up. So you should allow us to play hide and seek. In a very big place where we can hide a lot and seek a lot. And I wanted to answer. I said, no, you have to answer. What if there are 10 kidnappings? Will you allow us to play hide and seek after that kidnapping? To which my daughter, which was 3.5 years old, said, yes, Mom, listen to that. He is the statistician. We don't have that way, don't we? We don't. When we're walking on the mall, we're acting as if the probability of a kidnapping is zero. And I can assure you that everyone here, including me, if we hear in the speakers, on the speakers, that a kidnapping has taken place, I will grab my kids harder, not let them lose them. And very likely we actually leave the mall, don't we? Why? It actually makes no sense. But that's what we are. We underestimate the events before they take place. And then we tend to overreact. We underregulate before the events take place. And then we overregulate afterwards. We are heading toward exactly that. I think we have the technology to change our measurements. I think that we need to actually produce more collaboration in such a way that we can actually measure those accidents much earlier and much better. Let me stop there and see you in a second. Thank you so much. If I am doing anything on the environmental side, and the answer is yes. It's super depressing. All my research is super depressing. But one thing that we only measure major, this is oil companies in particular, I'm trying to measure the frequency of accidents in oil companies. So one interesting thing is that this is a report. Every time there's a spill, doesn't matter the size, they have to report to the EPA. That's me, by the way, in Europe is the same regulation. And those reports are public information. Did you know that? Every accident. Can somebody tell me an order of magnitude how many accidents we have in North Dakota with shale oil? I don't know. Anyone has an idea? How many a year? Thousands. The actual number is on the thousands. Who imagined that? There are thousands, but we have no idea. In fact, not only that, communities don't even know that there was an accident on the town upstream. They don't know. Now, they could know because the data is public. So what we're doing is actually
On the environmental analysis, it's mostly about dissemination and organizing the data from the environmental organizations.
The idea is just report what it happens. Report how many accidents.
The same I'm doing with human trafficking. So what we're doing with human trafficking is just report how many there are and what is how many are moving.
Very few people know this, but for example, in the Super Bowl, so we track child prostitution by their phones. Okay, these are all military search. We have a lab at MIT. It's called the Lincoln Lab. It's joined with the Air Force. So we actually go to the deep web and the dark web. We web scrape all the dark web 4 times a day. So we know all the transactions and all the illegal transactions that take place. We cannot catch the guys because they're very good at hiding their identity. But we understand kind of the size and the capacity. One of the worst things that happens with these phones is that every time there's a convention, every time there's a sport event, phones from one city move to the other. In the Super Bowl, it's not the worst one, by the way, but in the Super Bowl that took place in Atlanta, 1,200 phones from minor girls between the ages of 15 and 17 that were in the city of New York moved from New York to Atlanta. 1,200 By the way, the Washington is Final Four in basketball. So a lot of what I'm doing is disseminating this. What is the chance that, for example, the shrimp has been produced by a slave? There are 47 million slaves, which we call this modern slavery, but there are 47 million slaves in the world. If your shrimp has been deveined and no head and deveined, the chance that that was produced by a slave is about 25%. How much they pay for one human being? $90. 90. It's not wrong with accent. 90. One life. They stay on the boats with a life expectancy of between 5 and 7 years. If I could tell you that, the next time you're in the supermarket, what shrimp are you going to buy? By the way, if it's all dirty with the head, the chance that that was produced by a slave is almost zero. So you know what? Clean your shrimp. Clean your shrimp. Pay more. By the way, they're more costly. Of course they're more costly. Of course they're at the price. But I think you can afford it. So one thing that I want to do with a lot of this is dissemination, organizing and disseminating data. It's kind of producing indexes like inflation indexes, an index about livelihood that you use a slave, livelihood that you use, and the one on, I am helping law enforcement with other things, but this one for you guys, for your audience, will be about dissemination. I saw a hand somewhere there. Yes. So the question is, what is the difference between the data that we put together on the CPI versus the one from the World Labor Statistics, you know, for example? So the first, it depends a lot on the country, okay? So there are countries where the discrepancies are very big. So it's very easy to detect the countries where the discrepancies tend to be very big. The country's name tends to start with Russia. So, yes. It used to be Argentina. You see, the big data changes. So, no, but for developed nations, which I think is kind of part of your question, for developed nations, what happened is that the inflation rate, when you look at the year on year, they tend to be incredibly similar. The difference would be on the third decimal. So, very, very small differences and small discrepancies. Now, the difference is on the timing. So online prices tend to be more violent than. What I mean by that is that when they go up, they need to go up faster and buy more than offline stores. The CPI is biased toward online, offline stores, mom and pop, brick and mortar. The online, we only collect online. So therefore, we tend to see inflation rate about 3 or 4 months before it happens. The inflation rate about 3 to 4 months before it happens. Because of the natures of the markets are really different. But in the year on year, they tend to be very, very similar. Yes.
searches on Google. Therefore, I have no idea how valuable you are. And by the way, Google should be charging for every search. And by the way, this is Google, Wikipedia, Uber, and all that. What these stores, they do is that they subsidize, the sale of the goods, because by subsidizing the price of the goods, they can obtain information from the network. And information is very valuable. The information does not, is not on the CPI. So Wikipedia is not there, YouTube is not there, Facebook is not there. By the way, people that have computed the value added of these activities is about $2 to $3 trillion. So that's 15% of the GDP. We don't know it. We don't know how big it is. By the way, 15. Second, we have no idea what is the inflation rate of that 15. But you know, the way I compute it, I check what are the revenues from marketing sales from Facebook. You know, last year, worldwide, they increased at 24%. In the United States, about 34% per year in the last 2 years. So in other words, there's a 15% of the GDP that has 30% inflation. I think that we are not counting that. And we are not taking that into account because we are not doing the two transactions that we should be doing. I pay you for your data, and you pay me for the search. So we are underestimating GDP, we're underestimating productivity, we're underestimating inflation, and now we're making decisions based on that crap. Good luck. Good luck. And by the way, I think it's going to take major institutional changes for that to be detected. Because somehow, we in the United States, we believe that there's a God-given right that Google's searches in Google or in any search engine are free. But surprisingly, Netflix is not free. We pay for that. You see, that is properly accounted in GDP. So, from the economic point of view, I would love to be able to know the value of private information and that we will be able to improve it. This will reduce or improve our measurements of poverty and actual true inequality. The poor are getting a lot of free goods, and we just don't know how much. We have no idea. No clue. They are supposed to get an income. They are supposed to get an income from their information. But instead of giving them income, we give them goods. We give them search on YouTube and Facebook. You understand that if I gave the poor $2,000 a year from a family that has $24,000 a year of income, they might decide to spend that money differently than spending the money on searches in Google? We're forcing them to make a choice. So if we could actually change that, you understand how many lives and standards of living we could improve? So on the economic side, we'll be better. On the real side, I would like to eliminate racism and discrimination. But that I look at the data, that's why I mentioned. Last question.
Do you have your thoughts on China's social currency and, you know, how it balances with the government of collecting data and privacy?
So in China, right now, they have this social score. Everybody knows about the social score in China? So China, collecting information from your GPS, which is your telecoms, from your credit card, or your mobile system of payments, Apple Pay, things like that, and your information, for example, on your financial accounts, and then the searches of Google, I think they combine those four, they construct an individual. They construct something about the individual, and they give them a score. So if you visit a webpage that is inappropriate, then that score goes down. If you cross the street in an incorrect place, that score goes down. And therefore, somehow, they use that score for social policy. That can actually be done in the United States. If we just pick the companies from Silicon Valley, it takes 10 seconds. We could do that in the United States very easily. So I want you to understand that the fact that the government is doing it doesn't necessarily mean that we are not doing it here as well. I think that Cambridge Analytica did a great job on that. Okay, that's an example.
So, my view of that is, I think that, let me put it this way. Every time I search in Google, I tell Google something about myself. And every time I watch a movie Netflix, I tell Netflix something about myself. Every time I choose, you know, songs that are sad, and she, you know, in Spotify, if I listen to Chicago, they know I'm depressed. Everybody gets, okay? So but the beauty of that is that if we use that information for the betterment of the individual, I'm all for it. You see? If Spotify uses the information to send a text to my wife saying, Roberto is sad, please give him a call, that is a great use of that violation of privacy. If they use that information to give me an advertisement on chocolate, and they're going to sell the chocolate at the moment, which I am more vulnerable, I do have a problem with that. You understand that here is how that information is going to be used. What is the intention? In China, they're using this for law enforcement right now. So they're using this for someone that actually speeds. And you understand that the average speed of my phone in the car is probably the average speed of the car. That don't make sense. You know, I was once in a taxi in China, and I was telling the guy, give me your phone, and while you drive, I'm going to be throwing your phone backward, okay? Because I need to get to the airport faster. Unless you do something like that, really difficult to actually change that. So they're using that privacy to enforce discipline right now. And what is interesting is that the Chinese society is perfectly fine with that. I am not, personally not fine, but it's not me the one that has to make that choice. I mean, remember, on that framework of promise, the institutions, the law enforcement, and the rule of law, it is very important for them right now. So they're willing to give up their privacy for the accomplishment of that. By the way, you are willing to, you are. If I tell you, imagine that we have credible information that there is a terrorist attack in LA, and I need to know the GPSs of everybody here, and I said, we will actually solve that in 2 hours. Will you give me the authorization to look at your GPSs? Everybody here will say, yes. Absolutely yes. And then, but if you use it only for the tourist attack, if you're going to use that now to know where to shop and then send me advertisement, then I have a problem with that. Is that clear? So it is the intention. So right now, the Chinese society feels that they're using this correctly. My fear is that it might be true today, but the question is, once you have the information, once you have the data, once you have the vehicle to analyze the data, how are you going to behave 10 years from now? Can the government commit not to use this improperly? And that's the question I have. If they're going to use this, for example, that if I say something bad about the government, that somehow is going to affect my livelihood, that I can't go to school, I think that that would be bad. So, I work for law enforcement, you understand that? So, I do want to violate privacy sometimes. But the way I have solved my moral dilemma is that I work on the worst type of crimes. So, human trafficking, child pornography, therefore, I don't need, and no one will tell me in a court, oh, you cannot actually don't do it. So, in that sense, I work on the worst, so it's easy for me not to have to deal with that. But if I had to construct a social indicator, I think I would have a lot of problems. I would need to be very, very sure that you cannot identify the person. You see? It would be great to know what is the consumer confidence of this group, but not to say that one person in particular, they has an excessive amount of confidence. That I don't want. That's what the privacy protection becomes. So you prefer to construct statistics about social groups to protect your privacy. That's where I'm going. I mean, that's the way I'm going. Anyway, I've taken 4 minutes more. Thank you so much for your time.